A reading from the book of the prophet Zephaniah. Shout for joy, O daughter Zion. Sing joyfully, O Israel. Be glad and exult with all your heart, O daughter Jerusalem. The Lord has removed a judgment against you. He has turned away your enemies. The King of Israel, the Lord, is in your midst. You have no further misfortune to fear. On that day, it shall be said to Jerusalem, Fear not, O Zion, be not discouraged. The Lord your God is in your midst. A mighty Savior, he will rejoice over you with gladness and renew you in his love. He will sing joyfully because of you, as one sings at festival. Verbum Domini. Exalt you just in the Lord, sing to him a new song.
Exalt you just in the Lord, sing to him a song.
Give thanks to the Lord on the harp, with the 10-string lyre, chant his praises. Sing to him a new song, pluck the strings skillfully with shouts of gladness.
Exalt you just in the Lord, sing to him a song.
But the plan of the Lord stands forever, the design of his heart through all generations. Blessed the nation whose God is the Lord, the people he has chosen for his own inheritance. Our soul waits for the Lord, who is our help and our shield. For in him our hearts rejoice, in his holy name we trust.
Giver of the law, come to save us, Lord, our God.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Dominus vobiscum. Lectio Sancti Evangelii secundum Lucam.
Gloria tibi et Domine.
Mary set out in those days and traveled to the hill country in haste to a town of Judah, where she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the infant leapt in her womb. And Elizabeth, filled with the Holy Spirit, cried out in a loud voice and said, Most blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And how does this happen to me, that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For at the moment the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the infant in my womb leapt for joy. Blessed are you who believe that what was spoken to you by the Lord would be fulfilled. Verbum Domini.
Laus tibi Christe.
In the Old Testament, we have foreshadowings, or prefigurements, or images, or types we speak of the mysteries that we find fulfilled in the New Testament, in the New Covenant, in Christ. And we've been We've had a number of readings this past week about these types and images. We can think of the crossing of the Red Sea as an image of baptism, the manna in the desert as an image of the Eucharist, as a prefigurement of the Eucharist, the entire Exodus event as Christ's work of salvation for us, his deliverance of us from sin and death. And then what we've seen recently are barren women being made fertile, right? The wife of Manoah, we have Elizabeth today, we have referenced Hannah tomorrow. And this is an image of God's redemption for us, for Israel, right? That he is bringing new life to us. We had the prophecy made to Ahaz, a virgin shall conceive and bear a child, fulfilled in Mary, but certainly prefigured with these other Old Testament women. So they are shadows which point to a coming fulfillment. And St. Paul says in Colossians 2:17, these are only a shadow of what is to come, but the substance belongs to Christ. Right? They give us the categories, they help us to understand this fulfillment that Jesus brings, what he brings us, the reality of our salvation. Mary, Vatican II teaches, is a type of the church, but not in the way of the Old Testament figures, but as John Paul said, in her, the spirituality proclaimed and represented is completely fulfilled. She is not an imperfect prefiguration, but she is the spiritual fullness, which will be found in various ways in the church. So we see her not as pointing to something, but she is that spiritual fulfillment. So in her, the spiritual reality of the church is completely fulfilled, and she lives in a perfect way what would be fulfilled in the church by her immaculate holiness, by her virginity, by her betrothal, by her motherhood. All this is what the church is. So in Mary, the spiritual reality signified is already eminently present. In her, we as believers see how we are to be disciples, how we are to live in communion with Christ, trusting in him, placing our hope in him, and loving him. And I think that's why when Mary is preached, it resonates in us, right? The truths of our faith have a certain resonance, Vatican II speaks of. We see in her our call to discipleship, right? She shows us, she's the pattern of holiness. She shows us how we are to be and to live in this world. We see today that Mary's, you know, the greatness, her greatness and her joy is a result of her faith. You know, Zechariah, as we heard yesterday, is mute from disbelief. Mary brings joy and proclamation of good news to Zechariah's house, which has fallen silent. Right? Elizabeth is filled with the Holy Spirit, and she exclaims, "Most blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb." You think about the muteness, the silence of this house, and everybody's praising God, right, when Mary comes. She's bringing Christ, right, in her womb. John the Baptist is filled with the Holy Spirit. He leaps with joy. And even Zechariah, as we'll hear later, is filled with the Holy Spirit. And he prophesies, right, in that beautiful canticle of Zechariah. So all this is a prelude, we could say, to Pentecost, the sending of the Holy Spirit. Mary's bringing Jesus in her womb, and Jesus, of course, gives us the Holy Spirit. And it's also a prelude to Christ's evangelization. She is bringing good news to Zechariah's house. And what Jesus is going to go proclaiming the gospel as the church proclaims the gospel today, this is a prelude to that. And we see that Mary acts with haste, right? She travels to the hill country in haste to a town of Judah. We see in her a fulfillment of our first reading today of Zephaniah. We're told, "Shout for joy, O daughter Zion, be glad and exult with all your heart. Fear not, O Zion, be not discouraged. The Lord your God is in your midst." So we have many readings like that, you know, going up to the mountain of the Lord, proclaiming glad tidings, you know, because what God has done for us. He is at work, he's acting. So the Lord we're told, is in your midst, right? The prophet Zephaniah today, the Lord is in your midst. And that's what gives us joy, right? It's not all up to us. It's not solely our efforts and our works, but God is at work here. Tertullian said that nothing disconcerts the human mind as much as the simplicity of the divine works when compared to the great efforts the great effects they obtain. Right? And that so resonated with me. I know traveling to the Holy Land, and recently I made a pilgrimage of the footsteps of St. Paul, and you see these places that Paul was, or Mary was, in Ephesus, or in Nazareth, or in Jerusalem, and you see the humility of these places, and the humility of God, you know, to be incarnate. And in that simplicity and humility, the power of God radiates in a very splendid way. We see his power more clearly in these outwardly humble and simple works, right? There is a great beauty to seeing in these things, you know, God's work in his most simple and reducible form, right? His beauty shines out in a very powerful way. And that's disconcerting, right? We got all the plates spinning, the balls up in the air, juggling and trying to make all this stuff work. And then God achieves his purposes through the most simple things, right? Mary's a teenage girl, not a religious leader. She's from, you know, Nazareth, not even mentioned the Old Testament. Jesus has a hidden life 30 years in Nazareth, right? He's completely missed by the world, born in the stable. Yet God is at work, and we see his power, because he does not need the great things of this world. He's God. So in faith, we know God's at work, and this, as we see in the scriptures, sets our feet are running, right? We see the resurrection. People immediately, you know, after this encounter, go and proclaim what God is doing, evangelizing. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 9, "Get you up to a high mountain, O herald of good tidings to Zion. Lift up your voice with strength, O herald of good tidings to Jerusalem." Proclaim it. This is what God is doing for us. So the gospel invites us to joy because we have been set free. God is at work. His salvation is at hand. He's at work in our lives. He is on the scene. And Pope Francis loves to quote Pope Emeritus Benedict in saying that being a Christian is not the result of an ethical choice or a lofty idea, but the encounter with an event, a person, which gives life a new horizon and a decisive direction. So it's not just some philosophy, it's not just human effort, but I've encountered Jesus Christ, I have communion with him, he sets my life in a new direction. We have received love, so we feel the desire to share it. And that's what we see in the visitation today. Mary sets out in haste. Pope Francis has recently, in his latest apostolic letter on the joy of the gospel, he's urging the church to be all about this evangelization, that we all are on a mission. And he writes, I invite all Christians everywhere at this very moment to a renewed personal encounter with Jesus Christ, or at least an openness to letting him encounter them. I ask all of you to do this unfailingly each day. No one should think that this invitation is not meant for him or her, since no one is excluded from the joy brought by the Lord. The Lord does not disappoint those who take this risk. Whenever we take a step towards Jesus, we come to realize that he is already there, waiting for us with open arms. Now is the time to say to Jesus, Lord, I have let myself be deceived in 1,000 ways. I have shunned your love. Yet here I am once more to renew my covenant with you. I need you. Save me once again. Lord, take me once more into your redeeming embrace. How good it feels to come back to him whenever we are lost. Right? We are renewed and forgiven by the Lord. We have communion with him, and that makes us part of the mission of the church. In whatever way, wherever the Lord plants you, and whatever even small thing you can do to help proclaim this good news of Jesus Christ and what he's done for us.